Tēnā koutou kei ngā kaiwhakaero i te kupu, nau mai hoki mai ki Tapatahi, te hōtaka motuhake a Whakaata Māori, e pāna ki te huakito o te mate karauna. Whakatau mai ki tēnei pai kōrero, ki konei anō tātou wete ai, matapaki ai ngā take nui o te wā. Welcome to Tapatahi, thanks for joining us. Coming up on the program today, the Ministry of Health has released details of how it will serve Māori in terms of COVID-19. It comes amidst concerns Māori have lagged behind in testing and that the government response is a one-size-fits-all pandemic plan. The Deputy Director General of Māori Health joins us to discuss the Māori response action plan. And we get feedback from a Māori health leader. What are we doing to support our mums and babies during COVID-19? We speak with Oranga Tamariki and the Māori Women's Welfare League. And we end today's program with an Elvis Presley number performed by Pianika Duncan and her two babies.
Come on everybody, take a real deep breath then. And love my baby.
Love my baby.
Love my baby. Hey, and my baby loves me.
But first, here's what you need to know in 30 seconds. Well, it's day 26 in lockdown, and it's D-Day. We'll find out at 4 p.m. this afternoon whether we'll be staying at Alert Level 4 or moving to Alert Level 3. Cabinet meets today to discuss the next steps the country will be taking in response to COVID-19. We'll bring that to you live at 4 p.m. on our Facebook page, website and on telly. Now to the numbers for the day. There are 9 new cases, 4 are confirmed, 5 are probable. There are no new Māori cases, the total remains at 121, which is 8.5% of all cases. There have been 12 new cases in the last 8 days. There is one new Pacifica case and a total of 66, which represents 4.6% of all cases. 912 have recovered, which is an increase of 45. The total number of cases is 1,431. 18 people are in hospital, including 3 in ICU and 2 are in a critical condition. 83,224 people have been tested. The Ministry of Health has released details of how it will serve Māori in terms of COVID-19. It comes amidst concerns Māori have lagged behind in testing and that the government response is a one-size-fits-all pandemic plan. However, the Māori Response Action Plan promises to strengthen initiatives for Māori. It also acknowledges health disadvantages for Māori even before COVID-19. With me now is John Whanga, Deputy Director General of Māori Health at the Ministry of Health. Tēnā koe, John.
Tēnā koe katoa e mā takitaki ana.
Tell us, what are the main strategies in this plan to help Māori cope with COVID-19?
I think two main strategies. One is the strategies that we're working on specifically linked to the funding announcements from Māori ministers 2 to 3 weeks ago, and also a strong focus across everything we're doing in COVID-19, having a very strong Te Reti and Māori equity focus. So I need to stress a couple of things. This is the initial plan, and this is a plan that we expect to be building on. As you've seen, COVID-19 and the situation around COVID-19 is quite fluid at times. And so we need to be able to respond to that. I think secondly, the work we're doing in there, particularly in the Māori initiatives, are very much about supporting our existing Māori health network. We have over 200 Māori health organisations around the country, and there are over 100 of them that we're supporting, put on frontline services to our people across the country. That support is both to support them be able to regear themselves towards COVID-19, but also the particular services we're going to need. Services for our priority groups, our care, those with chronic illnesses, services around vaccination, services, for instance, around testing. There's also work, as outlined in the plan, that's being led by other parts of... Are you still there?
Yes, we can still hear you, John.
Oh, sorry. And so that work will involve work around mental health, particularly the psychosocial plan. There's work around extended community-based testing, continuing to do work around vaccination. And there's also work that we're doing with other parts of the health system and primary health care to make sure we've still got good primary health care services for our people.
Just so you know, John, we are experiencing some technical difficulties, but we can hear you clearly, so we'll continue with our conversation. Are you happy with the time that it took for a plan, a specific Māori plan, to be developed?
Yes, we had to make sure that we developed the plan in conjunction with both other parts of the ministry, the National Health Coordination Centre, and also obviously with iwi and Māori organisations. There's been quite a bit of work done on the national plan, and so we had to make sure that our plan dovetailed into that plan, because don't forget, as I said, there's a focus on two things: what we're doing to advance particularly the Māori initiatives announced by Māori ministers, but importantly, looking across all the other activities we're doing to make sure Māori are prioritised.
There is a view that it took far too long for the ministry to develop a plan and to respond to Māori need.
Yeah, look, as I said before, this is the first initial plan, and there have been challenges along the way. And look, to be honest, there have been challenges both externally encouraging us to do things faster. People haven't been entirely happy with what we've been doing in the first couple of months. And I think my view is we need to learn from that and embrace that. It's really important that we've got good, strong, external iwi and Māori commentators making sure and keeping an eye on us and making sure we're focusing on the right. So there's learnings from the first 2 months, and those learnings will be what we take into how we work on the next iterations of the plan.
Do you believe that Māori have been served well enough so far when it comes to COVID-19?
My response to that is that we can always do better. We had significant and persistent Māori health inequities prior to COVID-19, and they continue to exist now. We need to keep working on that. So that's why I'm always looking for what can we do better? What are the learnings from this round? And there are some learnings. And I think those will come off the back of particularly our external commentators holding us to account. So I think we can always do better. I'm not trying to dodge your question. It would be always my view on any given day that we can do better. We've had significant, persistent Māori health inequities for some time, and we need to keep working purposefully at how we're going to address them.
Can you give us an example of where you could be doing better? You mentioned before that there have been some key learnings. Can you share some of those with us this morning?
Yes, I think getting alongside some of the innovation that's come through, so the way we've had remote consultation, the way we've mobilised primary healthcare services, I think prior to COVID-19, there wasn't always an agreement that those were areas we needed to move in. What COVID-19 provided was we had to move. And so I think there's some really good examples of mobilised Māori health services, whānau care, whānau water, and other Māori health organisations doing things differently with our communities and iwi and Māori partners. And I think it's really important that we pick up on those things and look at how we can manage not only the next 6 weeks to 3 months, but the next 9 to 12 months and the 12 to 24 months after that.
It looks as though the plan relies heavily on Māori organisations, who you mentioned earlier, doing a lot of the mahi themselves. Why is that?
Look, I think first of all, we should be working with those communities, those iwi and Māori communities. It's absolutely essential that if we're going to have good community development, we must engage those communities. So whatever plan we did forward would have required us working with iwi and Māori organisations. What we have to do is make sure we understand what their needs are and how we can get alongside them to support them. So I don't think the issue is about their role. They have a very important role. It's what we do to make sure we get alongside to resource, support them to be able to do their role better.
I suppose my point in that question is more about a lot of focus being on those health providers. What other support is the government looking at providing in addition to that support?
Yes, look, I think there's work being currently undertaken by government looking at other social support. Just this morning I was in Azui with the Whānau Water Commissioning Agency, Oranga Tamariki, Ministry of Social Development, looking at that, not only what current and future health services are going to be required to help our people at need, but also how we then need to join them up with other social support and family support initiatives, because the impact, the health impact, will also broadly turn into a larger social well-being impact as we go through and deal with the further consequences of COVID-19 outside of health, and in particular socioeconomic circumstances and employment.
We've interviewed a number of whānau ora providers and Māori health providers on this program, and there's no doubt about it. The work that they're doing is simply amazing in our communities. I just wonder whether or not they're being given enough support to be able to do this very important role that they hold.
Yes, look, again, and I would say that's similar to the question you asked me about equity, I think we can do better. One of the things I remarked to the Whānau Ora Commissioning Agency this morning was that it's provided a really good opportunity for the Ministry of Health to work closer with the Whānau Ora agencies. And I don't think we've always done that as fully as we could have in the past. So again, it's turning a crisis into an opportunity. They're doing really good work there. We've been able to get alongside them and support them through public health initiatives, hygiene, for instance. And I mentioned to them today that I can see our opportunity to work more closely together, particularly with other agents, growing as we try and address the full range of needs that are going to be descending on our people too.
John Whanga, that's time, unfortunately, but look, we do appreciate this opportunity to speak with you today. Thank you for joining us. Tēnā rā tū koe.
Kia ora, Shane. Tēnā koutou katoa e mātakitanga ki ana. Kia kaha, kia maia, kia manawanui. E kore e mutu ngā mihi aroha, kia koutou katoa. Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou.
And of course, that was John Whanga from the Ministry of Health. Well, we did say earlier in the program that we were going to end today with Pianika Duncan and her beautiful babies, but we are having technical problems, so we're going to take a short break. But it's going to be a great break because Pianika Duncan and her two daughters have been using music to help others during COVID-19. The singer-songwriter comes from a musically inclined whānau and has been writing music for as long as she can remember. She says music is her passion and she loves anything that moves her heart and soul. Earlier this morning, I spoke with Pianika and her two talented and beautiful babies. Thank you, you and your babies, for joining us this morning. It's a great privilege to have you join us because, of course, we're looking forward to your waiata shortly. But before we go there, what has lockdown been like for you?
We've actually really enjoyed lockdown. It's a time that we've been able to just chill out, slow down and sing, have fun. So we've been enjoying it and I've been baking more, cooking more, so we love it.
Now, of course, pre-COVID-19, you are very passionate about music. Has lockdown intensified that passion, if you like, enabling you to share your wonderful talents with everyone?
Yeah, definitely. It's been given me time to write my own music as well, but on top of it, just bring out my daughter's talents and just sing more often, which is what I like to do. Yeah, definitely.
Can you introduce us to your beautiful babies with you?
Yep. So this one here is Pianika Waiata, and she is 3 years old. And this one over here is Anataria, and she is
seven
years old.
Beautiful. Absolutely. Thank you all again for joining us this morning. Tell us, where do you get your inspiration for your music?
For what we are doing online right now, we're singing a lot of old school. And I was brought up on old school. My dad, that's all he played. Elvis and Carpenters and Bee Gees and all that jazz. So I've just been, that's all my children hear as well. So they really, really love that sort of music. Old school. It's the best.
Why old school? What about old school appeals to you so much?
I think it just brings back memories of my childhood, and so it's a bit nostalgic for me. But I don't know. I just enjoy the old school tunes way more than anything else.
And of course, you write your own music. What type of music do you write?
I would call it inspirational. I write a lot of gospel music as well. Yeah, that's probably what I'd categorise it as, inspirational gospel music, yeah.
And of course, you've taken to Facebook, you're online, you've been online quite a bit during lockdown. What type of feedback have you got about your talent and your music?
Yeah, honestly, most of it is all positive. Like,
99.9% of it is positive. You'll get the random negative, which is not even that negative, to be honest, but all of, basically all positive, which is really, 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 really cool. Yeah.
And I see that you've got quite a big following too. You post a waiata or a song up and it's viewed by thousands of people.
Yeah, yeah, that was a bit of a shock. Like, and heaps of it's from other countries as well, which is pretty, pretty cool. We didn't really expect that response, but people love it, and I think people are bored, but people also love the old school stuff too. And I think when it's sung by little babies, it's different, so, and they like it, so, yeah.
So tell us about the song that you're going to sing us today.
Yeah, so we're going to sing for you guys a song from Elvis, and it's called Come On Everybody from his movie Viva Las Vegas, I think it's called. Yeah, so we're going to sing that old school tune for you guys today.
Great, well, take it away. The stage is all yours.
Can you see them? Ready, baby? Gotta go really.
Can they see me?
Yeah, I think I can. Can they be, are they seen? There we go. All right, here we go.
Come on, everybody, let's snap your fingers now.
Come on, everybody, let's clap your hands
real loud. Come on, everybody, take a ready breath now.
Come on, everybody, and whistle this tune right now.
Come on, everybody, let's stomp your feet real loud.
Come on, everybody, take a real deep breath and
eat
and love him, my baby.
Love him, my baby.
I love him, my baby.
Love him, my baby.
Hey, 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 and my baby loves me. Well, there ain't nothing wrong with the long hair music like a wrong Beethoven bar. But I was raised with the guitar in my hand, yeah.
And I was born to rock.
Come on, everybody, and turn your head to the left.
Come on, everybody, let's turn your head to the right.
Come on, everybody, take a really breath and repeat after me. I love my baby. With the guitar in my hand, yeah.
And I was born to rock.
Come on, everybody, and turn your head to the left.
Come on, everybody, let's turn your head to the right.
Come on, everybody, take a really deep breath and
repeat after me.
I love my baby.
I love my baby.
I love my baby.
Love my baby.
Hey, 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 and my baby loves me. My baby loves me. My baby loves me. Oh, my baby loves me.
Absolutely stunning. Thank you so very much for that beautiful waiata. And your babies are just beautiful.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you again for joining us this morning, and take care of yourselves, and please continue to share your wonderful talent with the world. Thank you again. Tēnā rā tū koutou.
Hākite. Thank you, Shane.
Bye.
Bye.
Piuari. Hoi anō, kia hoki ake tātou ki tā tātou kaupapa matua o te rā. We return now to our lead story. An expert group of Māori health leaders, te whakakaupapa urutā, doesn't believe the Māori COVID-19 action plan goes far enough to keep Māori safe. They say there's little new in the plan that isn't already in place, and it doesn't do enough to account for the inequity in the health of Māori that already existed before COVID-19. With me now is Dr. Rawiri Jansen, a member of the Te Whakakaupapa Urutā. He's also clinical director at the National Hauora Coalition and a GP at Papakura Marae Health Clinic in South Auckland. Tēnā rā tū koe.
Kia ora, tēnā koe Shane, tēnā koutou hakarongo mai nei.
I'm not sure how we follow that waiata, David. Hoi anō, we'll try. Now, talking about this action plan, this response from the Ministry for Māori and COVID-19, what do you think of it? Is it enough?
Well, ka awa rangi rua nei au. Tā mātou o te rōpū whakakaupapa uru tā, he pōturi rawa te manatū hauora ki te arotahi ki ngā iwi Māori, ki ngā whānau, e pāna ki tā rātou māhere COVID-19. So ka whakaturia e mātou tēnei rōpū whakakaupapa uru tā, i runga nō i tō mātou āwangawanga e pāna ki te nui o te mate werewere mō te iwi Māori, i āwangawanga hoki mātou i te kore whai take o te pārongo mō ngā whānau, mō ngā hapū, mō ngā iwi. Andrew Cuomo says none of us have done enough. So I think, you know, the first answer is that this is a start, but there is a lot more to do. You know, that would be fair.
And to be fair, John Whanga from the Ministry of Health accepted that they could be doing much more and much better to support Māori. Tell us, how do you think they could be supporting Māori better?
Well, it's sort of a critique of this document, which, you know, he acknowledges as a living document, and we think that it provides real high-level aspirational statements, but it actually needs to offer clear, tangible actions that will be undertaken by the health system to address equity. So in the plan, there's no scope or time frame for the plan, there's no clear actions, there are no clear milestones, there's no plan to monitor progress or ensure accountability. There's no acknowledgement that Māori health providers and hapū and iwi are integral in the role that they play in managing COVID. And one more thing, there's no recognition that maintaining business as usual healthcare is vital for Māori. There is some funding. We do have a concern that the government will now expect all Māori providers to do all of the mahi required without any further support. So some more work to do there. You know, there's a whole mainstream healthcare system which needs to do their job as well.
And a system too that we know was broken before COVID-19. Doesn't that just make the job even harder now, even more difficult and challenging for people like you at the coalface, supporting our people directly?
Yeah. So let's be honest. Māori have not been well served by our health system prior to COVID-19. And that's clear in the Tribunal's Hauora report. There's an opportunity now for the wider health system to ensure equity of access, given our high proportion of health conditions that make us more susceptible to COVID-19. It's important that high-quality routine care is maintained, as well as equitable access to COVID-19 testing and treatment and care. And we know that Māori have a high proportion of being low-income, living in rural and isolated communities, having limited access to technology or food security or proper housing. We've got larger whānau units that are often intergenerational, making it difficult to protect our kaumātua and others at high risk of COVID-19. So, you know, before COVID-19 in Aotearoa, healthcare for Māori was already in deficit. So our view is that we have to prioritise responses to communities that are most vulnerable.
So far, Māori health providers and iwi-led whānau ora groups seem to have taken the lead in many areas, including testing. You mentioned before the concern around no additional support or funding to support these providers, like yours, to be able to carry out the important work that they do with our people.
Yeah, so the funding is what it is, and we think it's a start, but there ought to be some visibility on what else is coming. So Māori health providers and iwi have taken the lead because, like us, te rōpū whakakaupapa uru tā, they felt the need to take action and do something in the best interest of whānau, rather than wait for the Ministry of Health to take action. And I think they were very wise in this approach. And I commend Māori health providers and iwi, and I'm proud of the way that they've stepped up to the challenge. The question now is, the living document that is the plan needs to have lots of specific actions, and it needs to have some clarity around the resourcing for that.
Dawidi, I'm interested to understand whether or not your group was consulted on the report or on the plan before it was released. Did you get an opportunity to contribute to the plan?
Yeah, I did, because one of our members was offered the opportunity to look at the plan, but Te Ropi Whakakaupapa Urutā wasn't given a formal opportunity to comment on it, albeit we feel completely confident in being able to comment on all aspects of it now.
It strikes me that the Ministry could be working a lot closer with your group as a good start to improve the way in which they support Māori during this crisis. Is that a fair comment to make?
Yeah, that's a fair comment to make. We've released a position statement which kind of distills the really important features of the work that we want to be involved in doing. And one of those is mana motuhake, and we think that there's a place for the Crown to partner with Māori doing the work. There's a, we call it mana tauriti. You know, there has to be a very clear centering of equity as the intention as we go through COVID-19 response. So, yes, look, there is definitely opportunities for us to work with the Ministry of Health and with John Whanga, but across all of government, actually, because when you look at, if we look forward, we've got a whole lot of work to do in the recovery to the pandemic and the recovery from the lockdown. So it has to be right across all agencies of government.
It's D-Day today. At 4 o'clock this afternoon, the Prime Minister will be announcing the government's decision about what is going to happen, whether we stay in lockdown or move to alert level 3. Do you have a view on what the government should do?
Yeah, and it won't be helpful for me to make a prediction of whether or not we make that decision at 4 o'clock this afternoon, but I do have a view, and that is that we can't stay in lockdown forever, so at some point we're going to. And so the leadership from Cabinet and from the Prime Minister about when we do that is really important. But that is the opportunity for us to start planning now about what is needed to step down safely. So from essential services to safe services, what does it mean for those who've got pre-existing conditions? What does it mean for health services? What are they going to do differently? How do we restart the health services from our hospitals? How do we restart schools? And all of those things, I think that regardless of the actual decision at 4 o'clock, as to which day we do the step down, it's inevitable that we're going to step down. So it's really important that we're involved in the decisions around that and how to do that well for Māori.
Kei taku rangatira, Dr. Rawiri Jensen, thank you for joining us this morning. We do really appreciate your time. E mihi atu ana ki a koe.
Tēnā koe.
The most vulnerable members of society, tamariki, can be even more at risk during COVID-19 restrictions if whānau pressures increase. Without teachers or possibly even grandparents in contact with children, Oranga Tamariki urges members of the public to be vigilant and report any concerns on their 24-hour phone line. Oranga Tamariki says whānau can also still receive help 24/7. It's just delivered a little differently. With me now is Whaini Lambert, the Deputy Chief Executive of Oranga Tamariki. Tēnā koe.
Tēnā koe, Shane.
Thank you for joining us. It's great to see you this morning. Tell us about what is being done a little differently in terms of the support that now has been offered by Oranga Tamariki to whānau, to tamariki.
Well, quite a lot's been done differently, mainly so that we can make sure that the Prime Minister and the government's objectives around the lockdown are achieved. And of course, they're only achieved if we can minimise the movement around the country of non-essential activities. That being said, child protection is an essential service. Oranga Tamariki still has all of its sites operating, albeit with a skeleton staff. That recognises that during this particular period, as you've said, we do have concerns around the safety of children, given that we don't have the same eyes on children that we normally would when we have schools operating, when we have hospitals operating as usual. So that has meant that we've had to work a lot more in partnership, particularly with our iwi and Māori providers. And today I just asked for a bit of an update from around the country as to how our sites are working proactively with whānau water navigators, with community social workers who might be a part of our iwi or Māori social service delivery. And it's great just hearing some of those new ways of doing things so that we can make sure that the safety of children is being ensured, but also, more importantly too, that whānau are able to receive the support they need so that those conditions that create harm for children don't manifest.
Have we seen an increase in numbers during COVID-19 during this lockdown?
No, we haven't, and in fact we've seen quite a drop in the numbers of reports of concern, and that is worrying for us, but that just shows how normally reliant we are on reports from the education system in particular. And that's why we really need to make sure that whānau are reaching out to one another to make sure that although we're physically distanced, that we're not socially distanced. We also know that a number of families were reluctant to engage with government services before the lockdown, which is why we're wanting to really work with our iwi and Māori providers, many of whom have quite heightened levels of trust with these whānau rather than ourselves. And we're finding that they do have the connections and the trusted relationships with these whānau.
Are you suggesting, therefore, that as a result of COVID-19, families are not reporting cases to Oranga Tamariki or issues to Oranga Tamariki for intervention or for support?
We've seen a general drop in the reports of concern, not just from the education sector, but we've also seen reductions in the reports of concern that we usually would see from the community as well. That being said, you know, we would like to think that families are trying to reach out and support one another early rather than just reporting to us. So reports to us are important, particularly for those situations that have resulted in the immediate safety of children being an issue. And we are still responding to those emergency situations where children are in immediate need of care and protection, and we are still running those services. But we do need those reports coming into ourselves through our phone line, through our email, through our website, particularly at the moment.
We know from police that there's been a rise in domestic violence as whānau struggle with lockdown and financial strain. In what ways can people reach out to Oranga Tamariki if they need help?
So they can call our phone line, so that's 0508 326 459. There's our website, which is contact@ot.govt.nz, our website, www.ot.govt.nz, but also all of our sites are still open. So people can still go to our sites, albeit we'll need to be observing correct social distancing and the use of PPE, but we would encourage people to come forward through all of those channels. Also, we are connected to Women's Refuge, victim support. So there's those other avenues that some whānau might have some history with, where they might have a trusted worker who they've worked alongside, and we would encourage them to reach out to those important trusted people in their lives as well.
Of course, we know that in recent months, Oranga Tamariki has been in the news headlines for very much the wrong reasons. So I'm interested to understand from your perspective what COVID-19 now does and how that may have impact on your work to try and work better with whānau and iwi.
So when we ran our review of what took place in the Hawke's Bay, there were a number of recommendations that came out of that review, which meant that in the short term, we had to make sure that particularly applications to courts for unnotified entries into care, that there was a higher level of scrutiny sitting around those application processes, including sign-offs by regional managers, by regional legal leads. I think, though, what was also important was a recognition that we needed to be working more in partnership, particularly with whānau, hapū, iwi, so that they felt that they were a part of the decision-making process. What COVID has done is probably not change that course, but it's required the intensification and acceleration of that. Because our staff aren't able to engage with the community in the same way that they might have in non-COVID conditions, now we're even more reliant on iwi and Māori providers in particular to be working in partnership with us to make sure that we're providing safe environments for children, but also so that we can provide support to whānau that we need it. So it hasn't been necessarily a change in course as a result of COVID, but it has been an acceleration and an intensification.
Hoani, that's probably a good place to leave it. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. Tēnā rā tū koe e mihi ana ki a koe.
Kia ora, Shane.
Hoani Lambert there, Deputy Chief Executive of Oranga Tamariki. Kāti, mai I a tātou tamariki mokopuna ki o tātou māma kōka whāia. Pru Kapua is the National President of the Māori Women's Welfare League and joins me now. Tēnā koe, Pru.
Mōrena, Shane.
How has COVID-19 been for our wāhine, for our mums? Pru, can you hear me? Are you there, Pru?
I'm there. I'm
okay,
here.
I'm not sure if you caught my first question. I asked, from your perspective, in terms of the work that the League is doing, the very important work that the League is doing, how are our mums, how are our wāhine Māori faring during COVID-19?
I think there are a lot of challenges that our women have got at the moment, being at home, being with tamariki, and in situations where there is a lot of strain and stress anyway. So we're trying to work as hard as we can to be supporting them at this particular point in time. We're trying to make sure that our older members in particular are safe and that we can do as much as we can within our branches throughout the motu to be supporting women.
Can you tell us about some of that support? So what type of support and how are you providing that support to wāhine?
Well, we have we are obliged under kind of contracts to have a number of whānau. So we're continuing the support with our whānau. And we've got, as well as that, of course, we've got women throughout the motu who are volunteers. We're trying to get the kai. I think pretty much we're getting kai delivered through our wāhine and through their supporters in the community out to our whānau who need it, trying to get shopping for mamas who can't get out of the house or can't get to the supermarket. We've got, there's a whole lot of essential services that are needed at this particular point in time, and so we've really got people in all the different regions doing as much as they can to assist our whānau throughout. So we've also got our hookup amongst all of our members, amongst all of our branch members, to make sure everybody's okay and make sure everybody is feeling safe, is feeling supported, isn't too isolated, and that's particularly true in some of our more rural communities.
How much are you using social media, online platforms, to stay connected with your members?
I think we definitely, through our website, we've got contact numbers there so that people can contact us. We can then refer them on to the different groups that have specific skills or to our own branch members. So we are continuing to try to get information out to them. That's all on our website. As well as that, we are ringing around. We have our regional executives who are operating and are keeping in touch with their members in the areas. The branches are doing that as well. So while we have an element of social media through that and obviously through the link in our Facebook page, we're actually trying to do the physical ringing and contact as well.
At 4 p.m. this afternoon, the Prime Minister will let us know what the government has decided. First of all, before we talk about that, what do you make of how the government has managed COVID-19 and their response?
I think for us as Māori, there are some gaps. I think we are a little bit of an add-on. I'm not a fan of the one size fits all. It's fine for the majority population. But, you know, we know what we need in our communities. We can do it, and we are doing it, with or without government support. And I think there has to be greater recognition that a small group of people who are making decisions without input from a lot of the people who are on the front line, a lot of the people who have the expertise, is not actually good enough for us. I mean, I think it's not something that reflects what we need. It doesn't reflect our position as tangata whenua. It doesn't reflect the treaty obligations that we have. And so, I mean, I really think that we will have to look at this afterwards and say, how did we properly deal with the Māori response? And I think it will come up short.
What do you think the government should do? Should we stay at level four or should we move to level three?
I think probably from our perspective, you know, the economic implications will hit us hard as Māori. I think that we probably are ready to go to level three with some restrictions, and that, you know, I'm not entirely convinced that everybody who keeps saying, oh, well, are we safe to go down? We can't be 100% sure. We have to make sure we're doing that testing in our communities. You know, if we've got those border controls, that testing in place, we're a little stronger on our contact tracing, then we should be able to contain it. And I think that we're probably at a point where the economic implications are going to be too great if we continue.
Can I, on that point, can I ask, is the League across their membership in their interests in terms of the economic situation that they're currently facing? How much insight can you share with us about that perspective?
Well, we know that we are dealing with situations where within our whānau there have been redundancies. There are people who already were working in areas that have been affected right from the outset. So we know economically there are problems. We know, we don't have to look very far in our history to know that when we have any kind of recession, we are most affected. We are in the kinds of areas that get hit most of all. We don't have the kinds of tools available for us for, you know, it's fine for people to talk about homeschool and all of those issues, but we don't have that. Trying to get that out, there's, you know, there are gaps in all of that, and more often than not, those gaps are for Māori. I mean, we talk about equity, whether it's in health or whatever it is, but it's always a little bit of a add-on. It's something that people talk about at the end of a kind of statement. We're not seeing that. We haven't had it in the past, and we have to be absolutely vigilant to ensure that that is going to be met by government responses. And by us, actually. It will end up being us as a community. We've seen that with iwi, we've seen that with Māori organisation. We've taken things into our own hands and been effective at it. So I think from that point of view, if we can have the resources to continue to do that, and there's an acknowledgement that we know better about what we need, then there is a possibility that we might come out of this better.
Thank you, Prue. Kia ora, and that's our time, unfortunately, but we do thank you very much for joining us this morning. E mihi atu ana ki a koe o te rā koutou katoa o te roopu wāhine Māori toku I te ora.
Kia ora, Shane.
Now, don't forget, whānau, we've launched a competition where you could win $1,000. All you need to do is create a 5-minute video that shows the motu what you're doing during lockdown, and it must be fun. We'll announce the winner at the end of lockdown, which could be as soon as a couple of days, 3 or 4 days. So kia kaha, kia koutou. You just need to go to our Māori Television Facebook page, like it, and DM your video through. It's that easy. Well, thank you to all our guests for joining us today. Later this afternoon, we'll find out what will happen after this Wednesday. Will we be staying at alert level 4 or moving to alert level 3? We'll bring you the Prime Minister's announcement live at 4 p.m. Please join us here on our Facebook page, website, or on telly. And of course, we'll be back tomorrow to tell you what it means for you. Koe nā tapatahi mo tēnei rā, kia piki te ora te kaha me te māramatanga, kia koutou katoa. Hei kona mo tēnei wā.